pleased to participate in this great conference. I am Gregory Light. My topic is another proof of the energy ratio of a particle to wave equal to 3 to 1. I have only 3 slides. The first one is about motivation, where I will present a publication I recently had. The second one will be for me to present a paper which is under review, and then I close with a summary. So here, this publication is, let me change the screen, okay. Let me change.
May I help you, sir?
Yeah, okay. So basically the motivation is we have a very serious disconnect between inside an atom and outside an atom. This is very dangerous. If you look at this pandemic we are suffering from, we have the medical technology of vaccination. So we're racing for vaccines. My question to the medical scientific discipline is, what if one day, God forbid, we should have COVID-24, then what? So you can see we have this serious situation here, from physics to chemistry to biology to medical science. So you need to force an applied mathematician to connect the dots. So inside the atom, the space-time geometry has been non-Euclidean because directs are spinor. Outside the atom, day to day, we live in Euclidean 3 space. And this chasm really accounts for a whole lot of human suffering. So I aspire to connect from within an atom to outside an atom. Here's why my publication recently. Pauli matrices, as we all know, are 2 by 2, but I have casted to 3 by 3. The highlights here are an electron is not just up and down 2 states, actually 4 states in 720 degree cycle. Spin polarization is implemented and carried out by material scientists, and the intrinsic spin from direct spinor I geometrically connected. And then thirdly, additional perspective on the production and preservation of antiparticles is introduced. Finally, the role of imaginary numbers in quantum mechanics is revisited. And this will play a big part in my today's talk. So here, the abstract. So spin polarization is a major consideration in material science. It has day-to-day Euclidean background. But as I just said, the direct spinor is just not, because we have 720 degree for 4 turn for any spin half particles. So we want to bridge the gap by the linear algebra of complexification to cast imaginary number I in real 2-dimensional real space. You see, it is so common that we conduct eigenvalues, real and imaginary. We know all the time they are in our real living space. So why should we ascribe to the non-Euclidean geometry? So here I am presenting a three-dimensional space-time. So let me show the connection between this publication and my talk today. It's toward the end. So see all 3x3 matrices. Here. So the familiar special relativity has this equation here. On the one hand, we had a direct taking the square root of the equation, but let's consider taking the complex conjugates. And then we have real part for particle and wave, imaginary part for wave. Why do I say that? If you have a point particle which is left alone, its expectation of the velocity is linear in one dimensional r. But if you have a wave, we are talking about e to the I omega t, sine t, cosine t. This runs in circles. This is a wave. But then we have a question coming out. So what must be the energy distribution between particle and wave? So I have proved to be 3:1. So let me move on to my paper. Let me see if my share screen is. Okay. Which is under review. So abstract. So there are four proofs to establish 3:1. The first one is by Gauss divergence theorem, where I changed the units for the physical constants. The second one, I stick to the constants. The third one is a standalone proof. The fourth one is the simplest. Consider a ball of radius 1, the unit, then its spherical area to its volume must be 3:1. So let me continue then. So introduction. Of course, I'm talking none less than the topic existing for 400 years, wave-particle duality. So on the one hand, we have the wave aspect demonstrated by the double slit experiment. On the other hand, we have a photoelectric effect demonstrating the particle aspect. Then Planck Einstein has had the famous equation here. However, if you look at the right-hand side frequency, that has to be about wave e to the I omega t. Okay, omega equals 2 pi nu. So if this is a wave, then this energy E cannot be ascribed to particle alone. Now, it turns out this ratio 3:1 was or had been observed by Feynman in his analysis of the electromagnetic mass. So this 3:1 is not new. It has been known for 60 years. So now the setup of my analysis. It is, we simply focus on one singular photon of ball B of wavelength lambda, half of which is the radius r. So we have a mass contained in this capital B here to model one singular photon in the entire universe. Therefore, virtually the space-time is flat. So general relativity reduces to special relativity. General relativity reduces to Newton's law. So in the next, I shall have no misgiving to apply Newton's law because we are looking at just one photon in the entire universe. So let me move on to section number two to show the first proof, which I have presented to this fine institute before. So I will just talk about the centerpiece of the first proof. It is here. This is not equation 13, okay, equation 13. So we are applying Gauss divergence theorem to the gravitational field exerted by the mass M in this capital B, but we only want to talk about one quarter of the mass. So we do the divergence and passing to the other side of the equation, we shall find that it comes out to be 3/4 of the mass, its angular momentum. So here, so as you can see, I'm simplifying my talk here because my main talk will be proof number two and proof number three. So coming out of the divergence theorem is the angular momentum, because electromagnetic wave spins. So the angular momentum of a point particle carrying a mass of 3/4 m is the other side of the equation from Gauss divergence theorem. So I want to talk about the interpretation here. It is the wave mass of 1/4 m draws in by the negative sign when we do the differentiation. Okay, quickly let's see. Oh, I took the absolute value, but the detailed calculation will be shown in proof number two. So the 1/4 m existing as a wave field energy draws in 3/4 of the mass through the boundary of the B, radially converging at the center of B as a point particle, the photon. Okay. We need to take a pause here about the Gauss divergence theorem. So we all learn divergence theorem in calculus. It says, if a ball is losing its mass, the mass must go through the boundary. Of course, for the influx, likewise. But now here we're talking about one singular photon outside which there's nothing. So what's the energy we're talking about drawing in? The answer has to be the 1/4, a quarter of the m. So where does this energy coming in, can this energy being drawn into the ball, converging at the ball center, cannot rejoin the integrand. The integrand is fixed here. So where must the energy 3/4 m go? The answer has to be a different space-time, however coinciding with the wave space-time. In other words, we're about the same entity with the two different representations. On one space-time, it appears wave field. accounting for 1/4 of the M. The same entity takes a dual presentation, which is particle, appearing as a photon traveling straight line. So this is the essence of a proof number one. 1/4 in the end lead to 3/4. I now move on to proof 2A. So this time we want to go in details. So I factor out the radius capital R and I integrate from, not from 0 to 1, because we have the singularity 0 here. So instead, we integrate from 1 over the natural number E until 1. More to say concerning this later on. Then what we have here is by Fubini theorem, we integrate the volume over the spheres in the interior here. So lower R ranging from 1 over E to 1. But the divergence for the gravitational field is radial. So it amounts to differentiating this quantity with respect to lowercase r. Then the area for each lower r must be 4 pi r squared. So simplifying, we are here. Because of 1 over e to 1, this integration turns out to be here. You see the negative sign earlier I alluded to? Okay. So this equation 18 is one side of the equation. The other side is the particle. So we're talking about wave here. So particle. So basically the second proof is now confined here. Equation 22 is particle, 18 is wave. And the connection is here, there is one crucial step I forgot to mention. So when we got here, a crucial step is to divide and multiply by the square of the speed of light. It turns out this factor is none other than the Schwarzschild radius. Why do I say that? Because wave is imaginary I, therefore inside this B, the space-time has the metric G11 in Einstein's general relativity negative. So on the boundary, the G11, on the boundary of the B, the G11 must be 0. Therefore, this R radius of the B equals 2gm over C squared. Oh, by the way, it took me 3-4 months to move from proof one to proof two. Proof one, I altered the units. You turn out sticking with the units like G, like Planck constant, everything turned out to be much harder. So let's continue then. So here, so let's talk about the angular momentum of a point particle of a mass 3/4 of m. So by definition, it's the mass times velocity times the radius, r. But r is radius, Schwarzschild radius, and c is 1. So r becomes 2gm. Consolidating, we get this expression here. And what is this? This is equation, so if we multiply this equation 18 above by the mass density, we get the earlier equation from the wave. Let's go more slowly. Okay, so let's multiply the mass density over this capital B ball, okay, by equation 18. Equation 18 was here. So we're going to multiply this thing or here by N over the volume of the B, which is 4 pi R, capital R cube over 3. We're going to carry this out to see what happens. Because right now, as it stands, there's no mass here. This is volume. Because the integrand here amounts to acceleration. So there's no mass here. So to go from here to angular momentum, we need to multiply this thing by the mass density over the ball B. Okay. So remember, the next moment we are going to multiply this by the ball volume to arrive at the angular momentum of 3/4 of the m. So here, this is 3/4 of the m, of angular momentum of 3/4 of m is here. So we're going to see to it, indeed, the conclusion follows. So let's multiply. When multiply equation E was here by this, what do we get? We get this thing. What is this thing? This is equation 22 here. See, 3/4 times 2gm squared. What do we have here? 3/4 times 2gm squared, negative angular momentum. Okay, so this ends proof number 2. Proof number 3 is stands alone. Again, it took me a couple months to go from proof 2 to proof 3. Let us decompose the mass, the total mass m, into that from wave and that from particle. So the wave mass lives in the interior of a B as an electromagnetic field. This wave mass has the center mass positioned, emphasized, at the ball center. Therefore, this wave mass is represented by the volume of the ball here. Yet, the particle mass m sub p is assumed by a singular point, coincidentally at the ball center. So we have a very serious distinction between the center of a mass and the point happened so at the center of mass. Then what? Let's consider a radius anywhere from epsilon to the boundary. Pick any lower r, any point q on the sphere. Then what do we have? We have acceleration exerted, caused by this particle mass by the Newton's formula. But you can see this acceleration must apply to all the points, not just q alone, but all other infinitely many points on the sphere. So we have to multiply this effect, gravitational effect exerted by the particle photon by 4 pi r squared. In so doing, you can see we do not need to fear what if r goes to zero. No, when r goes to equal to zero, the spherical area also goes to zero. This means that each slice of the sphere from epsilon to the ball boundary, we have the same gravitational mass due to the particle. Consequently, we can talk about the gravitational mass throughout from epsilon to the boundary by multiplying the same 4 pi r squared by r, and what we have here, we get 3 times the volume of B. So this was the third proof. So I'd like to draw a closure now. So the description of a singular photon in the entire universe would be, number one, the point of photon gamma, which appears exclusively in the particle spacetime, punctures the particle spacetime with a mini black hole. Due to it possesses 3/4 of the mass energy. Number two, this mini black hole contained in the particle universe also is contained in the wave universe. In other words, this mini black hole is the intersection of the two space-times minus the particle point P. The particle appears in the particle space-time. So the remaining quarter of the E existing as wave energy appears exclusively in the wave space-time invisible surrounding the mini black hole. Number four, the wave energy existing in the annular region of a ball minus a mini black hole has its boundary of Schwarzschild radius. Number five, the particle spacetime and wave spacetime coincide as our universe, like two identical stamps pasted as one, the top stamp being particle spacetime, the bottom stamp being the wave spacetime invisible. So now, earlier I mentioned there in my integration, I integrated from 1 over E. Now I need to make a justification. Here, is there a justification for the above integration from the capital R over E to R? Here, consider the identity. I equals this thing relates 1 in real line to I in complex plane. So you can see the connection from particle to wave takes the form of exponential function here. So I just want to say that this a business of embedding R for the particle on R square, which by complexification, the I turns into cosine t. So R times R squared is R cube, and we are living in R cube. So this I does not need to be regarded as something abstract, something imaginary. So let me change the screen to make a final summary. So as I alluded to earlier, my personal view is a whole lot of sufferings for our human species for the past nearly 100 years since 1920s to now is the interpretation of the eye. Somehow my cursor cannot point. So now, this I, if the complex plane in conjunction with a real R can be embedded in R cube. In so doing, what's inside the atom and what's outside the atom simply are existing in the same space. Granted, it's a dual, a diagonal manifold. So again, I'm grateful to the society, to this fine institute, to have me to present this talk. And I wish all very well in this pandemic. Thank you very much.